So week six, we are midterm now. It's just the middle of it all. So this week we're doing the child with hematologic and immunologic dysfunction and the child with cancer. Also, there is a CJ Sims due and NCLEX questions due. And make sure you do the NCLEX questions that are in the modules in the areas. They tend to guide you through the course and what you need to have, okay?
Miss Bogart, I'm sorry to
Yes.
interrupt you. I just need some clarification. It was really difficult to hear you and what you were saying on the other Zoom. So are we not taking the quiz? You're just going to do the lecture,
We're
correct?
going to do the lecture, and then when we're done, if you want to stay over, we can do the quiz in the end.
Okay.
Okay, so that my class gets what they need, and then you can have the quiz in the end if that's what you feel to do. Okay?
Okay.
All right, let me mute everybody so we have a quiet classroom. All right, let's go ahead and let's put up the PowerPoint for tonight. I know that Dr. Arsenstall uses the same ones as me because I'm the one who makes them, and I do send them to everybody. So, hematologic and immunologic dysfunction. Well, we can measure that with just a simple old complete blood count, a CBC. A CBC is a blood count where you look at white blood cells, red blood cells, platelets, and we can see hemoglobins and hematocrits, what's going on with the child. The other thing that's very important is the history, that physical. What's the kid look like? What's the history? Are they pale? Are they lack of energy? When you see a child lack of energy looking pale, that child, you can almost be guaranteed that they are an iron deficient anemia. Because when you don't have enough oxygen and iron being carried around in your blood, your body says, hey, I'm tired. I need my food. I need my iron. I need my oxygen. And that they tend to conserve it, the bodies conserve it by just sitting down and resting. Now, when you talk about just dairy, it's really not a great source of iron. So those children that are over one are getting whole milk now. So they're not getting much iron. And we know toddlers, they're picky eaters too. So put those two things together and you see a lot of toddlers with iron deficient anemia. Also, immunologic, if you're having a lot of infections, you're getting sick all the time. Something is wrong with the immune system. And of course, bleeding. Bleeding, we're going to go into also. So the red blood cell disorders, we know we call them anemia. This is the most common of things. And it is when you have not enough red blood cells. And again, what do red blood cells do? They carry oxygen and they carry iron. Without that, the body's not getting served its meals. It's not getting what it needs to survive. So you have a child that's tired, that's fatigued. Now, we do know that there's many different ways that a child can be anemic, and we're going to go into a lot of those. Children, they say a hemoglobin of 10 is your cutoff. Now, in adults, that's on the lower side, but on children, it's actually okay. Now, the types of anemia, whether it's decreased red blood cell production or increased blood cell loss, that's your bleedings most of the time, right? Or bleeding disorders. And then an increased red blood cell destruction, that means they're dying too quickly, so the body can't keep up with them. So when we talk about decreased red blood cell production, usually it has to do with nutritional. You're going to see iron deficient anemia. We're going to see B12. Those are the two things that we're looking at with nutritional usually. Then you go into bone marrow failure and you get to something a little bit more severe called aplastic anemia. And we're going to go into that's a lot of different things that are missing. And then, of course, your leukemias. Your leukemia, you're getting chemo, your body is not producing what it needs, and you're going to see that anemic child with leukemia. Now, bleeding, that increased red blood cell loss. Well, sometimes we can determine that, and we'll see that a child comes in having a lot of nosebleeds. They'll first say, okay, it could be they had a little virus. Let's paint their nose a little, some Vaseline, lubricate it. And then the kid continues, nosebleed, nosebleed. That's when we're going to be doing probably bleeding coagulopathy blood tests and just a simple CBC. And many times that simple CBC is all we need, and it's showing deep decreased platelets. Platelets are an integral part of the clotting cascade. If we don't have them, you're going to bleed. One of the diagnoses is ITP, idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura. P for platelets, decreased platelets. And we're going to go into that. And then DIC is just an overwhelming, the body is usually septic shock, trauma, all of the above together, DIC. Sickest child, adult you'll ever see is with DIC. Now, increased red blood cell destruction, sickle cell disease. You know, many people do have sickle cell. And it's not just that the cells are shaped like a sickle, but they also die really quickly. So you're going to have low hemoglobin, hematocrit. Another thing is thalassemia. And these are cells that die very quickly. Also, I call them my rectangular red blood cells. And we're going to go into what that's about. There's something called G6PD. And in my career, I saw one child. And I didn't know what it was. And the mother had to teach me. And then I had to look it up. It's when sugars introduced into the body, certain sugars, the cells does not like them, the red blood cells, and they burst. They don't like it, so they burst. So no red blood cells. You're going to have a low hemoglobin hematocrit. You'll be anemic. And I found it out because I needed to give something for fever. And she said, no, he can't have regular ibuprofen, regular acetaminophen. They both have sugar. So I had to call the pharmacy and get a non-sugar different source for them. And of course they had it, but of course I had to ask for it. And then of course there's always that toxic immunologic infection sort of thing that can cause increased red blood cell loss and destruction. Now, when you see a kid who's anemic, number one, you could tell. They look tired, they're pale, usually the lips. A lot of times it's ears. You'll see them very pale. And the blood doesn't have a lot of cells. So there's a lot of loose space and it just whips around and swirls a lot. And you're going to hear a murmur with this one where they have no cardiac issues, et cetera. Now, because you don't have enough red blood cells, again, you don't have oxygen. You don't have the iron for food. So the heart says, well, let me beat a little quicker. Let me beat a little quicker. And what happens, the heart can go into failure. So it is serious. It does need to be treated. You will see some bluish, even on a little bit of exertion, you'll see that cyanotic areas. Maybe it might be on the lips or maybe you'll see them in the fingers, believe it or not. And because you're not getting nutrition to the cells in young children with anemia, they're going to be a slower growth or growth retardation. So how do we manage this? Well, you have to diagnose it. Like I said, a simple history physical. See what's going on. Have they had frequent infections? Are they getting tired easily? What's happening? And we're going to do that CBC and we'll see it in those results. Now, if the hemoglobin and hematocrit are low, they don't want a child's heart to beat so fast that they will treat the, you know, just symptomatically treat that anemia before they can treat the cause of the anemia. So they'll give a blood transfusion. Remember the one thing with blood transfusions, any reaction, the first thing we do is turn it off, stop it off, right? We just stop it. And it could be a fever, could be a rash, could be shortness of breath, could be a couple different things. Now, if they don't need blood and the hemoglobin's okay, they'll just give a little IV fluid just for volume and they'll give oxygen. And it's actually controversial. When you don't have cells that carry oxygen, is extra oxygen going to work? So it's one of those, you know, okay, we'll just put it on because maybe possible. And of course, bed rest. Do not overtax that child. Keep them calm and let them have their rest. Now, as we're doing that assessment, looking at the history, how old is the child makes a difference? Like that toddler that's more apt to be anemic, right? And then look at the racial or ethnic. You know, African-American is more sickle cell. From the Mediterranean Sea area is more the thalassemia. So these things could be some clues. The history, what are they looking like? And then you always rule out GI bleed through a stool for alcohol blood, because maybe it's not anemia, maybe they're bleeding, right? And as always with kids, get them prepared. They're going to be getting lab tests. They're going to get a pinch. You know, let them know what's going on. And of course, always be honest. It's going to hurt us for a second, you know, and we're just, you know, squeeze your finger very lightly. Or if we're doing an anticubital, you know, needle stick, you know, make sure we use something numbing. I know in the pediatric hospital I came from, we numbed everything before we did anything. And it really made a difference in the care of children. And with anemia, you always try to prevent those complications. Now, iron deficient anemia is caused by not enough dietary iron. We know the first year of life pretty well is covered with iron. We know that they're getting iron fortified formula. They're getting vitamin D for breastfed babies, which helps. And breastfed, you know, is okay. They also, at 6 months, start to give food. What's the first one? Usually rice cereal. It's fortified with iron. So they're getting the iron that they need, and it can help. And then, of course, vegetables and whatnot, we know which ones will be good. Giving a baby just whole milk, the baby's not getting that iron that they need and the calcium, you know, what we should be getting. So we know that whole milk is not given until after 1 year. Now, how do we treat iron deficient anemia? Well, now we've determined if the iron levels are low, we know that they're anemic, we need to increase the iron in their diet, and then maybe iron supplementation. And iron supplementation could be the IM dextran, that Z-track, that deep IM injection, or it could be oral iron. Remember the kid who's getting oral iron, that the iron can stay in the teeth to sip it through a straw. Also, with any supplement of iron, whether you're given a pill to an adult or liquid to a child, if you give it with orange juice, it helps with the breakdown. Iron is started to metabolize in the stomach with the stomach acid, and orange juice helps that a little more. So sickle cell, if you have both parents with just a trait, your child has 25% chance. We know that it's African American and Native Africans. These are the ones, you know, that are more apt to get sickle cell anemia. Now, what is sickle cell? What is it all about? Well, sickle cell are these sickle-shaped cells, and they go through the blood vessels, and they get to these bifurcations with smaller little blood vessels, and sometimes they get stuck. And then they build on top of each other and can't go down lower distally. And it swells and the nerves get hit and it's painful and it gets swollen. And then distally, you can have local cell death, hypoxia, because the blood's not flowing there. So it's an obstruction due to the vessels being smaller due to whatever reason, and it can't go down. So how do we treat sickle cell anemia? Well, we know there are things that can make these crises occur. So we know trauma that can occur. That means, again, you're blocking blood flow due to swelling. Infection, fever. Why that? Because fever, you get more dehydrated. You need more liquids. Blood vessels are getting smaller. Stress always can cause anything. Dehydration is the worst thing. And then, of course, you know, lack of oxygen. So we could treat the symptoms or we can treat the cause. The cause is small vessels. Blood can't flow through it. So we need to dilate them. How do we do that? Priority, IV fluids. Now, it is painful. In the other hand, after I start the IV, is my medicine for pain. Absolutely, they need it. But you're helping for the reason of the pain, that congested vessel, that blood can't go through, that's too tiny. You're making it bigger with fluid so it can go down. And then you're putting heat on it, which dilates it too. Those are your priorities. And the number one, of course, is the fluids. Of course, we'll be looking for electrolytes. Mostly, I have seen in children coming in with sickle cell crisis, their hemoglobin and hematocrits, if they're 7 and 21, that's actually a good number. And we'll be giving blood at that number. I've seen it as low as 5 and 15 because those cells, they die quickly, right? And these children are pale, they're lethargic, they can hardly hold their heads up, and they're in pain, they're miserable. Now, children generally are more immunosuppressed, right? Especially your young children. They haven't built up immunities to anything. They haven't gotten all of their immunizations yet. So we do give prophylactic antibiotics. We give, actually, PenVK used to be the one at my hospital that used to give all the time. We give one pill a day or liquid, and it's from 2 months to about 5 years. And that helps that preventative of getting those crises. We do monitor reticulocyte counts to see how is that bone marrow functioning? Are they producing cells? Okay. And again, blood transfusions, we may need that because you're infusing oxygen-enriched cells into the body, and that will help. Now, prognosis, children live into to be adults. And the whole thing is trying to keep them from getting infections. Now, any immunosuppressed child, I mean, sickle cell is one of them, if they have a low-grade fever of 100.5, they need to call their physician because they need to be started on antibiotics. Remember, there's no immune system. These children are immunosuppressed. So bacterial infection is the leading cause of death. It is those children that get to treatment quick, get the IV antibiotics they need, are the ones that can live a better life and live into the fifth decade. So early intervention. As soon as that fever spikes, they're calling the physician or they're going to the emergency room. Getting that IV antibiotic is what they need. Most of them come to the ER because the pain is so bad that they need something. Now, sickle cell, if we see it in the chest, and it can be there, or it can be in the brain. There's blood vessels. There can be any area it happens. If it is in the chest, we need to tell that physician right away. It could be also pulmonary embolus, right? And if it's in the head and you have headaches, that could be a stroke, could be some neurological emergency. So those two are your high priority sickle cell crisis. The one thing about these children, they need to be treated normally. They need to get up. They need to get out. They need to be a part of what children do, but they need to be taught to keep themselves well hydrated. If they're playing sports, which they can, they need to have hydration and rest periods because it is the dehydration which causes those sickling attacks. Now, thalassemia is another one where the cells burst into the blood system. And what's inside a red blood cell? Again, oxygen and iron. So it is a very shortened life, and this is spewing into the blood. Now, as I said, these are descendants of people living near the Mediterranean Sea. So that could be a clue in the history. Now, you see four types of thalassemia. Usually, when you see anything about thalassemia, they're always talking about the Cooley's anemia, thalassemia major. And this is when the cells are bursting so much that this child needs to have blood transfusions to live because their body's not making cells. It's making them and they're bursting, and their hemoglobin and hematocrits are so low that they need transfusions. Now, when you're born, a baby is mommy's blood. Usually, about 6 weeks of age is when the change is seen. And we know all infants, up till about 3, 4 months, they're on mommy's blood. They're not making their own cells yet. And then they start making their own. So, it's normal for a child to have lower hemoglobin hematocrit, and you're going to see them anemic. But these children, they are more anemic also. you're going to have growth failure because you're not having oxygen, not having iron, and these kids need that to be able to have energy in order to eat, right? So how do we treat them? Well, we give them blood transfusions. And one of the things about thalassemia is, you know, they have this hemoglobin hematocrit from a blood transfusion, and then their cells die and it dips low. Then they get a blood transfusion and it's good. Well, this up and down makes the heart go a little bit crazy because as it drops, the heart's going to beat like nuts to try to catch up with that oxygen. And these children can go into heart failure. That's the bottom line. They can go into heart failure. Now, because they're bursting, as I said, there's iron in there. So we need that iron chelating drugs, the desferal. Or it, what it does, it just attacks the iron and they urinate it out. They also have apheresis. It is like a dialysis machine, but it is just takes out the iron, okay? That they have that ability. So how do we take care of these kids? Well, they need transfusions. That's the way that they do live. And they need something to take care of the iron that's there. One of the problems with long-term blood transfusion is they're going to get very sensitive. They're going to get these little antibodies, making finding blood more difficult. So it is always watching for those multiple blood transfusion reactions, et cetera. They're chronically in getting blood. So this child's life is going to be a lot around a lot of medical stuff. They can live into adulthood, but you can see the amount of care. As I said, common cause of death is their heart just gives up. It's just tired. They do try taking out the spleen to stop the production of these rectangular shaped cells, as I call them, that are bursting, putting all that iron out. But sometimes, because they're immunosuppressed, these children die of sepsis and multi-organ failure. Maybe, they say, and they're not sure, but they try to do a bone marrow transplantation. Maybe that's going to help the cells that are produced. Now, aplastic anemia. Most of the time when we talk again about aplastic anemia is pancocytopenia. And this is profound anemia, low hemoglobin, low hematocrit, leukopenia, which is low white blood cells. That means they can't fight infection, right? And then thrombocytopenia, and that's all about low platelets. So they're bleeding, they get infections, they're anemic, and they're tired. We treat this with immunosuppressive therapy, trying to make the body stop, you know, destroying these cells. And we do things very similar, chemotherapy, like leukemia. And later on, we're going to go into how to treat leukemia. And again, maybe bone marrow transplant. Now we're going to go into things that make you bleed. When you think of that, first thing you think of is hemophilia, right? And what is hemophilia? Hemophilia is when you bleed and you don't stop because one of the clotting factors in your body is not producing enough and you need all of them to work in order not to have bleeding. It does come from mommy, the X-linked recessive trait that it does go into the children and they do get it. Now, what we need to do is figure out what clotting factor is missing so that when they have these insults, they fall down, they bump their knee, it's swelling up, getting ecchymotic. We need to stop that bleeding, right? They need to know what factor that we can replace. They do home factor 8, factor 9 replacements, not uncommon. So there is factor 8, that's what we normally think about. And I gave it twice, I think, in my career, very early on in my career. And it's a vial of powder that you put liquid in and very carefully you rotate it till it's dissolved, pull it in a syringe and you slowly IV push it. That's factor 8, factor 9. Factor 9 is also called Christmas disease. And then there's something else called von Willebrand disease. There was some scientist named von Willebrand, and he determined that there is another factor with factor VIII that causes bleeding. So how do we sort of figure out, you know, these bleeding episodes? Sometimes it's very obvious. Could be chronic nosebleeds, epistaxis, or it could be all of a sudden you see bleeding going on, or mommy had it or had a trait of it. So we go looking for it. It does cause some sort of joint damage with hemoarthrosis. The joints in the body, just like the children, they run around, they fall, hit their knee, and it gets big and it blows up with blood and gets ecchymotic and painful, and there's blood bleeding in the joint sac. Well, that blood is very caustic and can cause damage of those joints. So we really need to teach these parents, once we figure out what's going on, that we need to get treatment and we need to take care of it. And next couple of slides, we'll get there. So what we will see with hemophilia is the low level of the factor, which is 8 or 9. Now, when you take the blood for that, sometimes it takes up to a week to get those results back. But that PTT, that's what we get right away. It is prolonged. And then when we do a CBC, platelets are normal. So we can say, yes, there's a bleeding coagulopathy. It's some sort of bleeding disorder. And then when we find the factor, we know what more to do. But parathyroid, thyroid hormone, and fibrinogen levels are also bleeding factors. So what do we do? Well, at home, you have a kid who fell down, knees bleeding, you know it's factor VIII. You do have factor VIII at home to do it. You have been taught. And what they'll do is give a home infusion. I had an 8 or 9 year old boy come in with his father one weekend, and he literally had a knee that was swollen and he couldn't get a hold of his hematologist. So he came into the ER to ask, do we give this factor? We don't know. And our physician said, yes, go ahead and give it. I had an orientee with me and the father said, can I do it? I said, you do it at home. Absolutely. Do you mind if we watch? Well, I watched this father wash his hands, draw it up. The child and him sat there and chose the vein, and it was a butterfly needle with a little plastic, you know, sides. And he held it there, and the father pushed it in. And it was not a big deal, and it was probably as good as I could have delivered it. I'm a little OCD with treatments. And my orientee was like, I could have never have done it like that. So they do give it at home and they can do it very well. There's also, we can give desmopressin. It's a nasal spray at home. Usually they don't do the IV, it's usually nasal spray. And this is for mild type things. And then aminocaproic acid sometimes. Now, our goal is not to let that kid fall down, bump his knee. A lot of these are toddlers that we're finding out has hemophilia. And what do toddlers do? They're into everything. They're like little drunk men waddling around, right? Banging into things, making sure we protect the environment so they can't cut themselves. I mean, coffee tables are notorious, right? Sharp edges. So making sure that those things are padded and protect. And then an orthopedic injury. Rest, ice, compress, and elevate. And that decreases the swelling. It compresses it. It's like putting your finger on what's bleeding and you elevate it. And that helps. And of course, rest. Calming the child down and letting them, their heart rate not be so elevated. So, we also, with these children, when we find out, we do tell them genetic counseling should be done. Now, what's their outcome? Well, they can have a normal life as long as they have gotten treatment and they don't have their joints been infused with blood and that they're able till not to be crippled or in a wheelchair. They do have a gene therapy coming out. We're still working on more of that. Now, the idiopathic or immune thrombocytopenia purpura, P, platelets, ITP, that's all about platelets. I have seen kids come in to the ER with either a nosebleed or they come in with bruising. And the mother's like, this kid doesn't play, doesn't go outside. He plays his games. I don't know why this child bruising or has a petechial rash, which looks like that arm there, but I usually see him on the legs. Do a history. What do we see? Well, we see they've had some sort of upper respiratory infection. And then we start looking. What do we do? CBC. What do we find? We'll see platelet counts about 20,000 or lower. So, how do we treat ITP? Well, initially, these children are admitted into the hospital. And as a nurse, you need to know they'll be put on bleeding precautions. That means we're going to tell them to not do anything with sharp objects, right? We as nurses are not giving any sort of venipunctures. We're going to look at the gums. We're looking at urine, stool, seeing if there's any bleeding. And we're going to be looking at the CBCs. At this time, we don't stick these children for CBCs every day. We can take it off the IV. This is one time that we'll say, all right, we're not doing that another stick because it's just going to bleed, right? And we're going to be given IVIG, IV immunoglobulins, and anti-D. And sometimes they do corticosteroids. Now, you've heard me mention epistaxis a couple times. Now, children, when they're bleeding, tend to have a moment, oh my God, I'm going to die, I'm bleeding. Especially those preschoolers, right? Toddlers, they're bleeding, they think all their body parts are coming out. And they're scared. As number one, try to calm these children down. I take them and put them in the mommy's lap so I don't seem so threatening. Those fingers, the thumb and the forefinger, pinch the nose on the bridge and lean forward. Why forward? If you put them back, they're gonna be swallowing blood and then they're just vomit and they'll continue to have bleeding, right? If after 10 minutes, they still are bleeding. We know that they need to tell them to go to get care. They might need something cauterized, or maybe it is leukemia, thrombocytopenia, or some sort of bleeding coagulopathy, hemophilia von Willebrand. Now, immune side, HIV/AIDS. Well, in pediatrics, the younger ones, is usually the infants born with HIV mother. Now, if the mother is up to date on prenatal care, many of them will get that highly active antiretroviral therapy starting at 22 weeks. And we continue when they're born with an antiretroviral. The goal in infants is to improve their immune function. Because remember, they're only born with mommies. And if this case with HIV, their immune system isn't great. We know that older children, adolescents, we worry about safe sex, et cetera. Now, I have seen triplets born with mother HIV. One had AIDS, one infant had HIV, and one infant was clean, had nothing. I've seen infants born with HIV mother, and by 1 year, zero converted, and they were no longer HIV. So it is possible through getting retroviral therapy, because that improves your immune system and fights it away. Pneumocystic pneumonia, most common infection that they get. And that's your respiratory. And then when you talk about other ones, it's usually candida, usually, either, vaginally or, in the tongue and the mouth. So we know that HIV, we need to, number one, be confidential with these children. Some parents hear that there is a child in the nursery next to them with HIV. They're like, I don't want my kid there. So again, trying to be as confidential as possible. So when we talk about blood transfusions, there's all types we can give. Whole blood, packed blood cells, platelets, albumin. There's so many things that we can do. Remember, the first thing we do if there's a problem is to, stop the infusion. And today you guys are so lucky because I didn't have this, growing up in the pediatric world. We didn't have infusion pumps for everything. So today we do. So use them, set them appropriately. Apheresis is what I said, is that dialysis thing that we have, okay? And it does remove whatever. It could be removing platelets for a platelet infusion on a patient with ITP, right? So it also can take iron out of the body on that thalassemia child. Then one of the things that we do look at, especially with hematologic problems, is bone marrow. What cells are being made? What does it look like? Well, I don't know if you've ever seen any of you worked in the medical field yet and know what a bone marrow aspiration entails, but you can hear a crunch when they get that big, that blue thing, and it's got a big end, and they turn it, and it is painful. Now, today, we put numbing on the outside. We take lidocaine and numb deeper in there. So please tell the children it will hurt a little bit. But, we do give them sedation. We do give something to help them deal with it. So if both parents have sickle cell trait, what's the chance that each of their children have sickle cell?
Okay.
25%, right? All right, a neoplastic disorder. Leukemias and lymphomas are half of the cancers in children. Leukemia. What is leukemia? Well, it's the body produces immature white blood cells that are useless. So white blood cell counts can be one, could be 0.1. And usually you're at least seven normally on a white blood cell count. So they don't have an immune system. That's what's going on with them. So they're immunosuppressed. It is the most common of all childhood cancers, but they've really worked hard on it and they're doing a lot of cures, remissions on these children. It's more frequent in boys over a year old, and you do see it around 2 to 5 years. And it is a long process of getting them to therapies, chemos, and then it'll go on, prophylactically that, we do a lot of that to kill all the cells. Now, leukemia, this is the definition. Unrestricted proliferation of immature white blood cells in the blood-forming tissues. As I said, immature white blood cells, they don't work. So what do you see? Well, I had a next door neighbor. She was older, so it wasn't the typical younger child. She was a girl, 13, something around there. And she was complaining of being tired. She was weak. She didn't feel good. She had a fever. She had bruising, and her knee was in a lot of pain. And they brought her in and did a CBC, and they did a blood smear to look at the cells. Her initial white blood count was 0.1. Her hemoglobin and hematocrit were low, and she immediately was admitted and got started the treatment. They do things like a lumbar puncture. They want to make sure, is it in the central nervous system? It makes a difference on how they treat it. And again, the bone marrow biopsy, always tell them, always be honest with your children. They'll appreciate it and they're not going to be afraid of us. Now, we start chemotherapy and there's four phases. The most important is the initial one, and it's called induction. And they usually put a port underneath the skin so that they don't have this central line with tubes hanging out all the time. And parents are taught how to put numbing cream on it when they need to come in, so they don't even feel this needle going in, and we tape it there. And the first 4 to 6 weeks, they hit these children with two, three, four, depending on the cancer and where it's at. They're going to give them all of this chemo. And the goal after this 4 to 6 weeks is remission. Now, they continue with the therapy. So they're going to put it intrathecal. You're going to take care of the central nervous system just to be sure, just in case little cells in there hiding, sneaky, right? And then, of course, they're going to go the consolidation therapy again, a little more, making sure that they got everything. And then they go to maintenance. And that's to make sure that they preserve that remission. Those first 4 to 6 weeks are really rough on these children. Now, sometimes you need to go and have a stem cell transplantation. Sometimes the chemo is not working the way you want. You want to get rid of the body that is producing, these white blood cells that are not working. So they do the stem cell. Now, if you're lucky enough and had enough money to be able to afford it, your infant has its own cord blood, right? This is when you would use it. So if you have your own blood or your own cord blood, we call that an autologous stem cell transplant. Automatically, it's mine, it's the best. Now, if you don't, still we can give others. So allogenic is all the others. So automatically mine is autologous and all the others. They say that the one that is the best of the everybody else, the all the others, is siblings. Because it was the same mom and same dad, they work. But you don't need the same blood types, all of that stuff. It doesn't work with this. So that's what the antigen matched or mismatched means. So again, always prepare these children. They're going to be going through a year or two of treatment. They don't need to be made afraid, and you really need to prepare them. Just like my next door neighbor coming in with all that pain. Make sure you address it. You give, the pain medicine as they need and do the things of distraction and hot packs and cold packs and positioning and all those things that can be done to eliminate pain. The complications is there's no white cells, right? So prevent infections. Good hand washing is always number one, right? Preventing hemorrhage, that means monitoring those platelets and monitoring hemoglobin, hematocrits, and anemia. And chemotherapy, being careful. I've been told and I have seen that pediatric oncology nurses with experience that are chemotherapy certified can get jobs that they want, let's say 2 year commitment. They'll give you bonuses of $25,000. That's how much in need they are. And I know who wants to work with cancer, right? Well, I'll tell you this. Every area that you work, there's always the ability that a patient is going to die. And I always say, it's not that a patient or child lived or died. What did I do for them alive? How did I take care of them? Did I give them their best last days? And did I give the parents their best last days? I know I have. I know what I've done because I know that I have parents 20 years later. Still reach out to me. I hear on them on Nurses Week. I hear on them on Valentine's Day, and I hear from them on my birthday. And they're always reaching out to Chris's favorite nurse, to Olivia's favorite nurse. And these are children that I took care of who died. Okay. Prognosis, we know, is pretty good, but what does it depend on? Well, what was their white count? Was it 0.1, like my next door neighbor? Today, she's a PhD in psychology from the University of Miami. She's doing well. Or is it 0.01? So there's nothing there at all. That makes a difference. How old were they? And what cell? There's acute lymphocytic leukemia and AML, acute myeloid myeloid leukemia, AML. Boys or girls makes a difference. And the karyotype is, what's their blood type? Is it a unusual type? Is it rare? Or is it the common A positive, O positive? And that does make a difference. So let's go into cancers, treatment, radiation, chemo, surgery. Those are the things. And we do a lot through a venous access device. As I said, usually it's your port. Again, what do you see? Cancer. Well, cancers eat up all sorts of cells. And again, pain, fever, ecchymosis, petechiae, and bleeding. These are all low platelets, low hemoglobin, low hematocrit, low white cell. All of those cause lethargy, weight loss, general malaise, anemia, right? You can see how it goes. And then those vision changes also occur. Now, one of the things with chemo, and it can occur in other children. They're in, you can have children in your block of patients, your clients that you've been assigned to. And one of the most serious patients would be that child who's having a fever with a low neutrophil count. Well, neutrophils are white blood cells. It should be 1,000, 2,000. It's a big, big number. Less than 500, there's no immune system. And they need antibiotics now if they're not already on them. So fever and a neutrophil count low, it's always your priority to take care of them. And always with these children, hand washing, putting masks on, always good infection control. Hemorrhage is always a problem, because your chemo is always not just killing chemo, your cancer cells, it's kills the good cells too. So hemoglobin, hematocrit, and platelets are always low. And one of the things they say with cancer, anyone on chemo, that they shouldn't be out doing activity, that they can fall and they can hurt themselves. I mean, absolutely no contact sports. We know anemia during that induction is the hardest part, where all of the cells are being killed, and so are the good red blood cells too. And again, with anemia, they're tired, so you need to give them rest. You know, when I started nursing, you had to vomit before we gave antiemetics. Today, we've gotten smarter, haven't we? We're going to pre-medicate to prevent. And we should absolutely, with chemo, they get their Zofran before they go in, right? To make sure that we can keep them. We'll help prevent it. Their nutrition, they're not going to feel like eating. They're weak. Sometimes they get swollen gums and whatnot. So how do we monitor nutrition in any person? Height and weight, especially children, right? And the diet, high protein, high calorie, full fat. I mean, give them as much calories as you can. As I said, you might have, you know, the mouth with sores and whatnot. So be careful of the foods that they're eating. And if they're in pain, give them something for pain so that they can eat. Constipation could be a problem. You know, these children aren't eating as well as they should, because they don't feel good. They're also getting pain medicine, which causes constipation. So we need to monitor their bowel habits. And stool softeners can help, because if they bear down too hard and you've got these low platelets, they could bleed into their brain and cause a stroke, okay? And there's also jaw pain that can occur. Again, giving them something for pain can help them get nutrition in. Hemorrhagic cystitis is something we have to watch for, making sure they're getting the fluid that they need, because, again, they don't want to drink, right? And then, of course, alopecia, the hair loss. I mean, I've seen fathers and brothers and, you know, uncles shave their hair for, you know, the little boys and the little girls to make them feel like they're a part of it. I used to go and have ribbons, all different colors, little spools of this, of ribbon, you know, the little ones about half an inch. And I would make these colorful little head things for them. And I'd wear one, and she would wear one for the day, and then she felt special. She didn't feel like she was a bald-headed kid. Also, steroids. You know, they are given. They do help in many different ways. But remember, with steroids, they can get swollen. Make sure their clothes fit them. You know, there's nothing worse than, a jammies or a gown that's just uncomfortable. And older kids, it's going to make them feel very self-conscious. And with steroids, it's always to monitor their salt intake because they are swollen. So with procedures, again, if we can sedate them, that to get on their developmental level, give them explanations, give them the hugs that they need, using numbing creams for them, and then using those deep lidocaine infiltration for things like bone marrow. Now, pain medicine isn't just always that morphine or hydromorphine. Remember, there's acetaminophen and ibuprofen. They actually, in between morphine, work well. And then calling sometimes in that the anesthesiologist, get a pain consult. They can have all different sort of resources. And remember, with pain, it's just not doing pain. It also has to do with positioning and hot cats and cold packs and children distraction. Giving them something to color, put on a, cartoons on TV, all of those things help. Now, there are two types of lymphoma, and you will confuse them. And let me tell you the differences. Now, Hodgkin's lymphoma is lymph nodes. It does metastasize, but it's usually from the shoulders up, okay? And it's usually the necks, like these picture. The big lymph nodes, they're sticking out. And the parents come in and go, oh my God, something's going on. But they're painless. They don't hurt him. But it's now getting bigger. It goes over and gets to the throat, and it can cause that cough and anorexia. And it could go into fever, weight loss, et cetera. What they do is see what's going on when it came, do the lab works, of course, and then they do a biopsy. And they'll find those Sternberg-Reed cells. So how do they treat it? Well, they'll do radiation. They'll shrink it. And then they'll do chemo, maybe with or without. Sometimes they like one or other. Sometimes they do them together. And then they do some surgeries on them and get them out. Now, whenever we're doing radiation chemo, remember, there's always that risk of infertility, of these children. So something that they should know. Now, non-Hodgkin's, you don't see it. It's diffuse. It's more of the history that they get. Yes, it's the same lymph nodes, the neck, underneath the arms and the groins, et cetera, but you don't see it. It's diffuse, and that's the word that you see with it. We will try to find an area to do some sort of biopsy on it, do x-rays, see CAT scans, see if we can find it. And they do, again, radiation, chemo, and trying to decrease, the amount of cells. Now, brain tumors. Brain tumors most common in children, believe it or not. The thing about brain tumors, what you're going to see is a child who has headaches that are getting worse. That will wake them up at night. You're going to see vomiting, not related to food or eating, and those things. And then you might see, falling over. I mean, it gets to the point of seizures and whatnot. It's gone far. But how do we treat these? Well, we're going to do radiation again. We're going to put that little purple blue mark on them, and they're going to get radiation. They're cutting a piece of brain out. They want to take the smallest amount that they can out. And then they may or may not do chemo, and then they'll do surgery. Now, preparing a parent for a child with brain surgery, really needs to be delicate. They come out and they've got tubes and pressure things in their heads, and usually they're wrapped up in this big turban, and their eyes can be swollen, and it's, you know, a really scary. So post-operative, like now you've helped the parents, you've talked to them about it. Now, how do we take care of the child? Well, of course, you're going to do those neuro signs, checking, you know, the eyes and the movements, etc. Positioning may or may not be on the side of surgery. So know what the physician says. The head of the bed, sometimes only 45 degree angle or 15 degree angle, know what the physician has written. And with anything with the brain, any brain injury, you always monitor fluid. You do not want fluid overload because it's going to cause pressure in the brain. And that area just had surgery could cause bleeding in there, right? And our goal with removing this tumor is to get that child back to where they were preoperatively. They might need to go to therapy afterwards, right? Physical, speech, occupational, whatever they need. Now, neuroblastoma, very, very infrequently seen. But what you see with it is it starts with a tumor in the abdomen, and then it gets big. And then all of a sudden, it goes to the brain. And usually we don't see it in the abdomen until we see symptoms of a brain tumor. And by the time that we go to treat them, these children are already metastasized. So it is a very poor outcome for them. Again, you're going to be, you know, teaching these parents, we're going to do surgery, we're going to do everything we can to help chemo radiation. But as I said, it's not a great outcome with them. Now, bone tumors, osteosarcoma. Usually it's the femur, long bones. Usually the femur is where you see it. And it's usually that pre-adolescent area where all of a sudden they are limping. They're not walking. It gets more and more painful as time goes on. And they're going to do an x-ray first. They might see a little fuzz on it. And then they do the CT, MRI, and then they do a biopsy. And they diagnose it as a osteosarcoma of the femur bone. Now, what do we do? Well, you can't just take the tumor off the bone. The whole femur bone must be removed. That's your leg, right? So what they have started to do is take the lower leg and attach it to the hip. So you have a foot, like that picture on the left, you see the foot? It is attached. The calf is up high now, right? And why they do it is so that we can put and fit a prosthesis there. Because without it, there's no, where do you stick something, you know, in order to make, and there are a lot of children, you know, do get this. So it's something that we want to get them back to, you know, some semblance of they can ambulate and move around without a wheelchair. The goal is to salvage that limb. Yes, McCormick.
How come the entire femur has to be removed and why not just the affected portion?
Because it's their cells are all inside the bone marrow of the femur. So they got to get the whole thing out or it's just going to reoccur.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
No, you're welcome. All right. So again, chemo's given and then they do it and then they're going to be getting therapy afterwards in order to get them moving. Now, Wilms tumor. It's something that I've seen one of in my lifetime. And it was right after the Haitian earthquake. Our hospital went down as rescue. And they found this little three-year-old boy that had a mass. And they had a religious group somehow got him over here to Miami Airport. Somebody, another religious group, picked him up and brought him directly to me in the ER. I was in triage. And I said, so what's wrong? And they go, we don't know. Here's the papers. They were in French. So I couldn't read it. So I had to do an assessment to try to figure out where do you put the kid? I don't know what's wrong. The kid was alert, but in non-distress, didn't have any huge abdomen sticking out like this one. It was, all right, I need to do an assessment. Well, first, I had to get on this little Haitian boy's level. So I did my little thing, sat real low, I gave him a sticker, did whatever. And then I showed him the stuff I was going to do. And I did his vital signs, did his blood pressure, listened to his lungs. I listened to his abdomen. And when I got to the left lower quadrant, there was like a softball size hard tumor. And for some reason that I had never seen one before, I went, this is a Wilms tumor. We can't touch this anymore. The thing with Wilms tumor is they're very fragile. And too much manipulation gets little pieces of that tissue into the abdominal cavity and causes metastasis. They don't even do biopsies on this here. What they do is they'll do chemo, maybe or maybe not. This little boy only had chemo and went to have surgery. Now, if you notice that incision, it's quite large. They've got to go all the way down underneath the intestines to get to the kidneys, which are in the back, and they go through the front back, okay? And the thing postoperatively is all that manipulation on the bowel can cause an ileus. So you're watching bowel functions, and it's a tumor on the kidneys, a renal tumor. So we're going to watch urinary output. So the biggest thing with this one, do not palpate that abdomen. Putting a sign up over the bed on the chart and making sure that nobody is touching that abdomen because you don't want to cause that child more problems. Rhabdomyosarcoma is a soft tissue sort of cancers. See in the ear, the nose, the gums, the ears, eyes, and they do remove it and they actually do very well. Retinoblastoma, this is a tumor of the retina. Ever see an animal outside in the dark when the light's on and you see the white eyes glowing? We call that a cat's eyes, right? You can see them. Well, if you look at that little child here on this picture, that one eye, that white, that's where the retina blastoma is. And that's how we determine them, just by that whitish glow, that cat's eye that we do see. And it comes from many different things. We're not really always sure. They do radiation on this because we don't want to get back to the nerve, which attached to the brain, et cetera. So they do radiation. So that purple mark, again, never wash it off. They need to go to the exact same place on the next therapy. And they do chemo. And what they do is they're going to remove the eye. Usually the whole eye comes out. And then afterwards, what they do is they'll put a prosthesis in. So it is an intense surgery, especially for parents. Actually, again, I've only seen one, and it was a 10-month-old little girl that I found it on. Germ cell tumors. We talk about women doing, breast exams every month. Men should do testicular exams. And this is a case where I've seen one incident of it that was an unbelievable thing to monitor. It was an 18-year-old boy who came in and he was complaining of testicular pain. And when we did our assessment and examination, his testicle was really enlarged. And the physician saw it and he said, all right, let's do the ultrasound, but let's just do an X-ray of the chest and the abdomen. Let's look to see if there's metastasis. And he had already metastasized in the abdomen, in the chest. So this didn't just happen. I think he was embarrassed to say, my testicle hurts. I don't know what else, but this child's outcome, he did die 3 months later from a testicular cancer. Liver tumors, well, we have multiple lobes, right? You could just take out a portion of them. So these are actually really good outcomes. Now, cancer today, we're doing so much better stuff with it. We have all different new combinations of chemo and treatment, and we really do a lot better with it. So our cancer rates are really good. And I love these Facebook postings, right? Cancer free after treatment for 2 years, whatever. And, you know, it warms my heart because that child's gone through a lot and they've made it, right? Any questions? All right, who wants to win a Kahoot tonight? I don't see anybody with their hands up. Come on. You gotta be enthusiastic here. I know it's Valentine's Day. So if you don't know, you take that little UPC code, put your camera on it, click to it, and you'll go right to the game. Or you can go to kahoot.it and put in the access code. All right, let me get going so that we can get done at a decent time. Week six, halfway through, guys. Which statement best describes a neuroblastoma? Remember, that's the one that starts in the abdomen and goes to the brain. Thank goodness that this isn't one of those that like a brain tumor or a leukemia. You know, it's not common at all, and that's the grace that I was talking about. But again, its diagnosis is after it's already metastasized, so outcomes aren't where we'd like them to be. Which is priority treatment for a newborn of an HIV positive mother? So we know mom is HIV. You know, what is our goal? Our goal is to keep this newborn healthy, right? How do we do that? And our goal is to improve the infant's immune system, basically. We're going to give antiretroviral drugs to this infant to try to, like acyclovir, to try to keep them their immune system as boosted as we can to fight it so they can be later on in life without it. What are symptoms of sickle cell anemia? So sickle cell anemia, it has to do with the blood vessels. There's an occlusion. There is swelling that goes on. A lot of times it's hands and feet, and it's painful. It can cause problems with vision. And, you know, if you're not feeding, you know, an area of the body, it's going to cause a delayed growth because they're not getting the oxygen and nutrition it needs. So sickle cell anemia affects which cells? Sickle cell anemia is red blood cells. Again, remember anemia, lack of oxygen, lack of iron that's only in the red blood cells. What kind of hematocrit would someone with sickle cell have and why? So remember, these cells die quickly. So it is lower. As I said, most children who come in sickle cell crisis, they mostly get blood because if they have a 7 and 21 hemoglobin hematocrit, I'm happy. That's actually high for these children, usually lower. What is the treatment for sickle cell anemia? So number one priority is IV fluids. Very good. Then of course, blood transfusion, and then maybe that bone marrow. Good. What is the reason children with iron deficient anemia are easily tired? So, iron deficient anemia, they don't have red blood cells, they don't have oxygen, they don't have iron, and they have no energy. The cells aren't being fed. Very good. Aplastic anemia includes a depression of which blood cells? I mean, treatment of this one is chemo. It's very much like leukemia treatment. And aplastic anemia is red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. So you have a child who's immunosuppressed, who doesn't have red blood cells and is bleeding. So this is a very sick child to be watching after. The most common type of anemia is. And it's iron deficient anemia. Very good. We can treat that. What causes pernicious anemia? They also call it megaloblastic. They talk about intrinsic factor with pernicious anemia. And it's a B12 deficiency. Remember, I told you if you look at their tongue, it's swollen and it looks like beefy red. It looks like liver almost. Like, oh, I know what this is. Which symptom is the single most common symptom of anemia? I mean, think about what's anemia. You don't have hemoglobin hematocrit. You don't have blood cells. You don't have oxygen. You don't have iron. You're going to be tired. Very good. When teaching parents about beta thalassemia, the nurse informs that the child is at risk for what? Remember, these are the rectangular cells, and they don't last long, and they die and explode into the blood system. What does that cause? No red blood cells, you're going to be hypoxic. And the iron in the red blood cells is spewed into the blood system, and it does cause iron overload, and it does need some sort of chelation therapy to get rid of that iron. That's how severe it is. Thrombocytopenia is ITP, it is not thalassemia. What lab values will you see with hemophilia? Well, think about what is hemophilia? What do you know about it? The PTT is prolonged, but the PT and platelets are normal. And as I said, when you see a child with bleeding and you suspect some bleeding diagnosis, those factors don't come back for, I mean, sometimes up to a week to get those back. But you do see that PTT right away and a PT and platelets. So those are very important values to remember. Priority treatment for a child with sickle cell crisis is, what do you do first? Priority. Priority is to take care of the reason why there is the pain. It's the blockage of cells in a vessel because the vessels are small. You want them to dilate so the cells can move. IV fluids is your priority. And of course, you'll also administer pain med, but take care of the reason. What is immune thrombocytopenia purpura? This is ITP. What did I tell you about that? What's the P? It's usually after an upper respiratory infection. It's usually we can cure it and it's gone. It is lack of platelets. So they're going to see petechiae. You're going to see bruising, maybe even ecchymosis, epistaxis. Thrombocytopenia can cause the following symptoms. And that's petechial hemorrhage, ecchymosis, and epistaxis, bleeding of some sort, whether it's that rashy look in petechial rash or bruising. Absolutely, it's what you see. A multi. A child with hemophilia has fallen, the knee is swollen and painful. Treatment would include what? And remember, a lot of this is done at home. These parents are taught, and we are going to elevate it. We're going to do cold packs, and we're going to do the rice, right? Rest, ice, contain, elevate. And if it's swollen and bleeding, most likely you're going to be giving the factor at home. What is the priority nursing action for a suspected blood transfusion reaction? The one thing about blood is to make sure that you read your nursing policy on how you're going to give it so that you always know that you're within policy. And number one, turn it off, get rid of it. It's the reaction, and then you take it and put the blood bag and tubing in a bag and send it to the blood bank. You know, when you see that, reaction, you're going to be calling the doctor to get orders. What do they want to do, depending on the reaction? So, a child is admitting with neutropenia. Which nursing action takes priority? Well, what's neutropenia? Neutropenia is a lack of white blood cells. No white blood cells, you can't fight infection. Strict hand washing is what you need to do. That is your priority. They don't need to be on contact or any isolation. It's you are going to prevent transmitting diseases to them. Hand washing. Which symptoms would a healthcare professional expect to see in a child with leukemia? It was like my next door neighbor. And it's that bruising because hemoglobin's down, hematocrit's down. You're going to see white cells down. Platelets are low. So it's bruising, fatigue, and then the pain on top of it. Yes. Your child with ALL has had recent lab results and the platelet count is 10,000. Nursing action, what do you need to do with that? You know, when we look at that platelet count of 10,000, could be any child that has low platelet count, whether they have ALL or anything else. It is a significant number, and you need to know what you have to do. And you worry about bleeding. So you put them on bleeding precautions. Very good. A multi. A child's placed on bleeding precautions for ITP. What interventions would the nurse do? Remember, ITP, immune thrombocytopenia purpura, P, platelets. What's your intervention? Of course, bleeding precautions, but what does that mean? And it's all the above, everything. No injections, look for bleeding, monitor that daily, usually daily CBC, the platelet count, and then corticosteroids. A child with Wilms tumor, which action by a nursing student causes faculty member to intervene. What is the student doing wrong? And we're going to, you're touching that abdomen, don't do that. And then I would explain to her what she's doing. She's creating metastasis. Cancer of the body's blood-forming tissues, including the bone marrow, is called what? And that's leukemia, blood-forming leukemia. A child with ALL has a fever of 100.5. What should they do? Remember, ALL, they're so immunosuppressed. They have no white count at all. And now they have a fever of 100.5. They need to either go and get treatment or call the doctor and get some antibiotics ordered because they will go into septic shock really quick because there is no immune system to fight. A child's having a bone marrow aspiration. What should you tell this child? I mean, if you look at the size of a needle that they're using, it is quite large. And as I said, you can hear that like bone crunching to get down into the marrow. And yes, don't lie. Just tell them it will hurt, but they're doing a lot better than they used to with it. Most common clinical manifestation of a retinoblastoma. And it's the cat's eye reflex. And actually, this is how we find these children, is by that little white eye or checking their eyes and seeing that shiny white. And that's where the treatment starts then. Your child has been diagnosed with a retinoblastoma. What information do you think's important to ask? You want to know if there's anything been going on with the eye. Has it been watering? Are they touching it? Are they banging their head? Are they crying? You know, rubbing their face in, especially the younger children. Something's going on, and probably those were those little subtle hints something was happening. A goal of surgery for a child with an osteosarcoma is what? And we want to salvage the lower part of the leg and put it up to where the femur was. So there's a place to put a prosthesis if we can. If not, it'll just be a pure amputation. But then how's the kid going to get a prosthesis placed there? What is it going to attach to? True or false? Immunizations cause autism. Absolutely not. That was a false thing that came out. A physician published this quote research article, and actually they found out to be a false research, and they took that doctor's license away. A child's complaining about these skin markings for radiation therapy. They should be told what? And they need those markings so that the next time they give radiation, it'll go to the same place and it will be more effective. A multi. Nursing care of a patient with immune thrombocytopenia purpura, ITP. Why do we need IV fluids for ITP? There is no blockage in the vessels. You do not need an IV for fluid embolusing. This is why this question is here. That is for sickle cell anemia. You need to dilate the vessels and give fluids, but it's all the bleeding stuff. No IM injections, monitor CBC, and corticosteroids is needed. When distraction is used, it helps what with children? Especially if they're in pain, right? Remember, distraction should be appropriate for the age of the child, and it's all of the above. You don't want the child sitting there thinking about pain. I'll put music on. I'll start dancing. I'll turn cartoons on. I'll give them puzzles. I'll give them crayons, anything to stop them from thinking about how much they hurt, and of course, medicate them as they need to be. What assessment question needs asked to a child with possible rheumatic fever? What question's important here? Rheumatic fever is due to an undertreated strep infection. So, have you had a sore throat or did you get diagnosed with strep lately? Because that's what it is. How do we treat rheumatic fever? Treat it with antibiotics long term, and everything but that heart valve is okay. Signs and symptoms of asthma, something from last week. I always will throw some of these in. Now, when you think of respiratory illnesses, there's these little things that are different in all of them. In asthma, you're going to see expiratory wheezing. In croup, it's swelling in the upper, so it's inspiratory, okay? Those will be some of your differences there. And the rest is right. Good. A multi. What symptoms should be reported to the healthcare provider for a child with sickle cell disease? Like, which symptoms here aren't good at all? And it's that headache, because it could be a stroke, or the chest pain. It could be heart, could be lung. So those things are emergent. Those need to be told to the physician right away. Absolute contraindication for nasal tracheal suctioning include which of the following? When should you not put anything in a mouth, basically, is what that's asking. No tongue blades, no suctioning, leave it alone. Because when you put stuff in the mouth, you're going to increase the swelling. So epiglottitis, croup, tonsillectomy, all of those things create more bleeding, create more swelling, and we don't want to take our airway and get rid of it by swelling there. Iron dextran is given via which route? Used for iron deficient anemia. That was the first IM injection as a nursing student that I gave. And it was on a younger woman. I was so nervous. Because it's IM Z-track. And the Z-track will make sure the medicine, you pull the skin up, you give it, inject it in, take it out, and then you pull the skin down. It prevents that medicine from coming back on the skin. It will stain it. And sometimes it burns the skin, and that's why it Z-track. IM, deep IM. A child was to receive their own bone marrow. This is called a what transfusion? I told you little names and tricks to remember. It is called autologous. Automatically, mine is the best. Allogenic is all the others. So own is always autologous. The other words have nothing to do with bone marrow. What cancer may present with painless, firm, enlarged cervical nodes? It's above the shoulders, right? Remember that. Because there are differences between the two of these. And it's Hodgkin's lymphoma, okay? Remember, non-Hodgkin's is diffuse. You don't see it like you do with Hodgkin's. A multi. When teaching about sickle cell disease, you would include what? So you want to dress warmly because you don't want the veins to constrict. So keep them warm. Keep fluids, always lots and lots of fluids. Pain medicine before it gets too bad. And any fever, they're immunosuppressed. They need medical care so we can get antibiotics started. Thalassemia major, Cooley's anemia, is treated primarily with what? You know, thalassemia major, Cooley's, they do have some facial differences to them, long bone sort of things, the upper jaw is bigger. But you just need to know that blood transfusions, they have cells that are rectangular shaped. They burst quickly, so they don't last long, but they spew iron into the body and lose oxygen. And the only way to treat these is to give them blood transfusion. There's no other treatment. Take out the spleen, that can help, but blood transfusions. A multi-select. What are opportunistic infections of HIV? I mean, I think it's adult and children here. I remember back in the 80s, I went to work at a trauma center ER, first time I ever stepped in the ER, and I had a patient who crashed and burned with PCP pneumonia. And this is in the mid 80s where they were just figuring out, HIV and PCP pneumonia. And it's something I'll never forget. I went home and I had to look it up. But PCP pneumonia and Candida, UTI and rashes are really, they don't consider those the opportunistic. It's the other two. Multi. Treatment of an osteosarcoma includes what? Bone cancer of the femur. What do we do? I mean, it actually could be osteohumerus, but usually it's the big femur, the majority of them. And it's usually that pre-adolescent stage. So, their emotion, their body image, it's a big thing, for these. And stem cell has nothing to do with cancer of the bone. It's the amputation, chemo, and we our goal is to salvage that limb if all possible. A multi. Who are the best donors for bone marrow transplantation? Donors. Am I going to do myself or am I going to do everybody else? And as I said, siblings are the best. Mom and grandma only have part of you. Remember, children are made from mom and dad. So siblings are the best. And of course, yourself. And then if you need to go to mom, grandma, but the other ones are better. What is the most common opportunistic infection for children with HIV? And that's actually your pneumocystic pneumonia. Yes, they can have Candida, but it's the PCP pneumonia most common. What would you consider to be neutropenia or a low neutrophil count in children? And it's less than 500. Remember, any patient that you get and their neutrophil counts are low and they're running a low-grade fever of any type, that is your priority patient. That patient has nothing for to fight infection at all, less than 500. This is what usually happens with chemo. They go into that nadir period where their neutrophil counts go into really nothing. And less than 500 is nothing. A primary characteristic of a brain tumor is. Remember brain tumors, you have headaches that get worse over time that end up waking them up at night. And vomiting not related to eating at all happens vomit, whenever before they eat and when they haven't eaten, those two things you'll see. And the balance also. The optimum treatment for an osteosarcoma is what? What is our goal? And we know our goal is to salvage the limb, have something. They take the calf from below the knee and reattach it up into where that femur bone attached into the hip. And then they have somewhere to put a prosthesis, and it's better for that child to be able to move around. Let's see how we did today. Last question. Child's receiving the induction of chemo. What does that mean? What's induction? Remember in chemotherapy, there's four stages of administering the chemotherapy drugs. And it's that initial intense 4 to 6 weeks of chemo, and the goal is remission at that point. Well, let's see how we did. Alicia, good job, Alicia. Number two. Brenda, number one. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Sierra, good job, Sierra. Number four, CB and Emily. So anyway, I know that you guys had a rough start. If you want to take that quiz now, let me get off of here and I can talk to you. Remember, next week is the exam. There are reviews going on. I did my first review already earlier today, so it's already on my YouTube channel. Those in the other class, I have a YouTube channel, Professor Bogart, Pediatric Nursing. All of my reviews, all of my everything is posted there. So if you ever want to go and listen, you may. It's open to the public, okay? My class, I will see you all next week, and thank you so much.
Thank you.